India comes at the top. Because India, like France, we like to debate, we like to have discussion. That's in our DNA. The main topic of the discussion is about time and space.
The Night of Ideas is an excellent platform to speak and discuss around these ideas and these challenges.
So you're here with us for the sixth edition of the Night of Ideas. It's an annual event which is dedicated to free circulation of ideas, new concepts, new understanding of established notions, established norms as well. And this year, the theme is closer, coming close. We're going to be talking about arts now, and specifically visual arts. And what we're going to have be showing you here, the works of a brilliant young artist and also a very brave artist here who's decided to address the issue of size and how it changes with time and how it impacts your well-being, your physical being, your mental being, and how it demands new space here as well. It's called Aged and Big, Yes We Exist by Natasha Sachdev.
Well, art has always been a reflection of our times, our lives, our hopes, our struggles, even our anxieties. More so in the middle of a pandemic, where the concepts of space and time have been so very hard to comprehend. They've been very fluid as well as hard to grasp. Which is why today we are getting you works of two artists, one from France, one from India, to show you how they have been reflecting these two concepts of space and time through their work across the year. So joining us here today is Natasha Sachdeva. Thank you so much for joining us, Natasha. She's been hosted by the Lalit Kala Academy here in Garhi, the very picturesque place of the national capital, Delhi. Natasha, how would you describe your work, your arts over the last 1 year in the middle of a pandemic and lockdown?
Well, I think it was a very hard time for all of us. And for me as an artist, I felt very bounded, you know, because as artists, you know, we are so much used to experiencing the whole environment, our surroundings. And while I come here to Garhi, the whole, you know, my journey of stepping out of the house, traveling by metro, coming here, you know, conversing with my fellow artists, my senior artists. So initially it was very difficult for me.
You're looking for images outside?
Yeah, of course. Like when I'm traveling by metro, you know, I sit in the ladies compartment and, you know, the whole experience of, you know, women coming and, you know, looking at their body languages. So it has reflected in my work. But then in the pandemic, there was no option and we were so much bounded. But then I realized that what I was searching for on the outside was actually on the inside. And it beautifully, you know, transferred into my works. And I guess it brought a lot of change in my works.
The theme, space and time, has a deep significance in my works in a vulnerable and sensitive aspect. I paint bodies that are heavy, bulky, and not very appreciated in the society. These bodies need more space than those which are slimmer, as if there's a lack of space for them in this world. I believe space should not only be discussed in terms of surface area, but also in terms of mental space. I have created various works where I'm distorting my own face, looking horrifying, to portray that we all are distorted in different ways. No one is perfect, and what may seem perfect is actually the most distorted. I feel speaking about the relationship of space and time with my works has made me even more sensitive and empathetic towards people who feel they are less appreciated and celebrated in this society. I will continue to work to make a slight difference in breaking the stereotypes about beauty and body through my art.
Beautiful, and it's been explained with so much emotion, of course, given that it's been a personal experience here for her. With that, we're going to be continuing to talk about culture with the star of visual arts here, And I'm going to introduce our third set of panelists here. We continue to have Mr. Sonam Wangchuk. We have Ms. Nandita Das, actor, filmmaker, activist. Good evening. Thank you for being with us here. We have Mr. Sanjeev Sanyal, who's the principal economic advisor to the government of India and author as well. And Mr. Christophe Jaffoulot as well, French political scientist who's specializing in South Asia and an author as well. Nandita, I want to start with you first. And this is particularly with respect to a creative person as an artist, as we've heard in so many other areas, in visual arts here, and in your area as well. It's usually work that builds up in solitude. It's that process of creation that builds up in solitude, and only later you step out to create it here. You've observed human relationships, world events. How do works of art change at a time when we're not close, when we haven't been closer? How does that change the creation or even the nuance or the emotion in the work of art?
I think the fact that art cannot be sort of narrowly defined, that art means different things to different artists, that there is no, I mean, it expresses itself depending on the context. We have seen so many world events that artists have depicted through their work. If you see, for instance, when there is, Iranian cinema, because there is a lot of, restrictions and artists are not able to express due to the political issues, that they have expressed in different ways. They have created a whole narrative which is very specific to their context, and yet they are telling their stories. If you see the World War, when this big event happened, there were so many stories that came out of that experience. So I think artists in some ways do reflect reality and do reflect the times they are living in. Yeah. So I'm sure, I mean, suddenly there are lots of stories that are happening about the pandemic, about the COVID crisis and this isolation that artists are going through. But we are yet to see, are we going to really forget in 10 years this whole experience, or are we going to truly learn from it? Because if you think of the Spanish flu, you know, how many films were really made about that, or the plague? You know, there weren't that many. In fact, there were far more films, let's say, about the World War. So sometimes also the commercial aspects, what is more dramatic? You know, what is going to sort of really bring out the stories? But I think because of the internet, something has shifted. In some ways, every story does have a chance. If you really want it, there are stories now coming out of individuals. You know, they don't have to be specifically known artists. There are people who are expressing themselves around the world. So I think we are yet to see that how this is going to manifest, not only in the immediate art that is coming out right now, but what's going to be the impact of it going forward.
Do you think that we've arrived upon a hybrid structure that exists even for the workings within the government here?
I think my own experience in the government gives a very different story. But personally, I have a split life, as you mentioned. And I'm a writer, and I also work in the government as the principal economic advisor. Now, if I had been a writer, I would have probably used this time to introspect, explore internally. But of course, I had to completely throw that out of the window because as you can imagine, this was, it's a health crisis, it's an economic crisis. And so I was working completely flat out through the entire period. I mean, weekends, continuously, 24/7, literally. I've not had a moment to breathe throughout this entire phase, including the time that I had COVID myself. I was still doing, obviously, online through video conferences, doing work, doing meetings, doing press interactions and so on. So all of it online, continuously with temperature. So there was simply not a moment to breathe.
Christophe, talking about how different is the relationship to space and time among different cultures, specifically, so to say. How does the perception of it differ between two areas, if we take between India and Europe?
Well, India and France, to be more precise, because today is the Nuit des Idées, Nights of Ideas. So I think it's interesting to contrast in the conception of time and space in India and France, because there is a clear contrast. And I think this contrast comes from the historical trajectories of these two countries. You know, France is a country of revolution, whereas India is one of the few countries in the world that has never experienced any revolution. Mm-hmm. And incidentally, that's true of most of its neighbors as well. And it makes a big difference so far as way countries relate to past, to the past, to the history. In the French case, clearly, the past has been partly erased. And a new society has been partly built, drawing its inspiration, of course, from individualistic values and laïcité, that is a break with traditions. And in India, on the contrary, to break with the past, the revolutionary way is out of question. And traditions are valuable or valued at least, and layers of the past are piling up. Yeah. The past is everywhere. In a way, it's not distant, but close, to return to your terms. And I found, for instance, very interesting the way antiquity itself is debated.
Can intelligent aspects of local culture impact geographically different areas as well in improving lives?
Yeah, one thing that I very much value in places like Ladakh, which are very, very resource challenged,
yeah,
is the sense of frugality, sense of, you know, maximum out of minimum, you know, using little resources and creating impact. We do not have, for example, all the wealth and resources to make a winter warm in Ladakh. Yeah? Yeah. It's cold. But our people have been very innovative, our ancestors, and that's what I would like to see in the world. And innovative not just with gadgets, with whirring gears and belching smoke, but for example, in Ladakh, the winters are very cold,
yeah,
but the way to deal with it has been, while children look forward to winters,
right,
because that's the time when storytelling starts, you know, all through the winter. And the day you see greens coming out, sprouting out, storytelling becomes a sin. Yeah? So that's the local culture that all children know, and grannies make sure they know that now the greens have come out and storytelling is sinful. I used to wonder as a child, why sinful? Why sinful?
Right.
I was very inquisitive. Later I found out that that was a beautiful way of reserving storytelling fun for the winters when there was nothing else to do, and in summer you have so much to do and entertain yourself in the fields, so you ban it in a way. That's a beautiful way for children to look forward to.
And while we're doing this, let's also take a listen in to a special message here that is coming from the chairperson of the Lalit Kala Academy.
Namaskar mitro, aaj aapke samne aane ke liye मुझे बहुत खुशी हो रही। भारत देश और फ्रांस एक साझा कार्यक्रम लेके आ रहे हैं। फ्रांस के तरफ से एक बहुचर्चित ऐसे स्टारों की दुनिया में कला विजन रखने वाले ऐसे स्टीफन बेरॉन, जो बहुचर्चित और बहुत सम्मानित ऐसे कलाकारों के डिस्प्ले, काम का डिस्प्ले अपने विचारों को साथ में रखे वो संशोधन कर रहा है। कई आप भी उसमें हो सकते हैं। ललित कला ऐसे विचारों का स्वागत करती है। फ्रांस के साथ में हमारे कार्यक्रम होते रहेंगे। आप कलाकार हो, उसी माइंड से आइए। आपका विचारधन इस देश को दीजिए, इस दुनिया को दीजिए।
The positive dimension is that well, some parents have discovered what it means to be a teacher.
Very interestingly, you're in Puran Nikila, one of the very first gifts that the East India Company brought to the Mughal emperors, to Jahangir's court, was clocks.
My name is Stéphane Baron. My artworks are about our relation to people and places on Earth at a distance. I have called this type of artworks planetary art. I am also very concerned since the 80s by ecological questions and our relation to the planet like it arises now with climate change, Anthropocene extinction and world pandemic. I have called this philosophical and art movement technoromanticism. The site non-site project is about our access to spirituality with the internet and our relation to Earth. What is our relation with spiritual locations or sites at a distance? The second series of artworks are specially designed QR codes printed red on yellow. These five red QR codes lead each to a Google Street View of a spiritual site. QR codes, pictures, relate the onlookers to the distant site, but there is a double relation because it seems that we are related to the places, but in fact we are just related to images.
Well, let's continue with that discussion that we've been having. As you've been told as well, we're at the Purana Qila here. We're sitting at the old fort, and this was built in the 16th century. In your understanding of continuously digging into history here, do you feel that the relationship that one has had with space and time in all of these years in the past centuries has changed today? The pace of it has changed, more importantly, if the digital world has changed that pace for us?
Well, I think it's interesting. It's very easy to see these things in terms of East and West. But I think in all culture, you have a period when time is viewed cyclical. And that comes from the agricultural season. It comes from the rounds of the heavens. It comes from the planets and the moon and the sun circling in a single year. And then as timekeeping gets more accurate, and particularly with industrialization, people begin to see time as linear. Mm-hmm. And that isn't something that is unique to either India or Europe. It happened in both. In fact, the French historian Jacques Le Goff, the Annales historian, is one of the men who's written most interestingly about this. In ancient Greece, you get the cyclical ideas of history, the age of heroes, the age of the gods, just like you get the Kalpas and Yugas of Indian cosmology. And then as industrial society comes, then things change. Very interestingly, you're in Purana Qila. One of the very first gifts that the East India Company brought to the Mughal emperors, to Jahangir's court, was clocks. They brought clocks, timepieces, watches. Because although India, from very ancient times, particularly from Gupta times, that had extremely sophisticated water clocks, they hadn't had accurate means of measuring micro time. Which European clocks were able to do in the 17th and 18th centuries. And I think you see both societies moving from this idea of cyclical time to linear time. I don't know anyone in modern India who still really thinks in terms of kalpas and yugas, mm-hmm. So much as getting home by 6 o'clock in a very linear sense.
For most governments, do you think each target is a short-term goal? We're looking at the immediate and the short-term. Are there any aspects to which a government beyond its term in power looks at a long-term goal?
And of course it does. I mean, you can't possibly run a large country or even a small country or even something as minor as, I don't know, your RWA, local RWA, without having long-term vision. I mean, projects are started by one government, they always spill into another government. You know, things like space projects or even highway projects run into years, in some cases decades. I mean, if you're looking at, you know, airports and things like that, are built, rebuilt, and continue to be. So, of course, I mean, space and time in sheer scale for a country our size means that you have to think in decades across governments and across ideologies and so on. And they have to be done that way. There is simply no other way to do it. And of course, as one of the earlier speakers was saying, in a country like India, we think in thousands of years sometimes because of the way we relate to issues. So there's no question that a government reflecting such a society has to take, think of things in very, very long spaces of time.
Well, I can speak about what I know the best, that is teaching and research, because that has impacted this aspect of society, not only because schools have been closed in many places, and that has changed family life to some extent. Mm-hmm. But I would say that the positive dimension is that some parents have discovered what it means to be a teacher, and they have also discovered what their kids were learning at school. Well, for my own experience as a teacher, I must say that online teaching, of course, has affected the relationship we have with students. And it's sometimes very difficult for the students to be that isolated.
And on that note, a very special thank you to all of you being with us here tonight, our panelists who've been here with us, our audience here in India, and our global audience as well. But we still have some more time for the two-hour window, and we're leaving you behind on a brilliant musical note. This is a very special collaboration here that has been done across continents. At a time when traveling, sitting together, composing together, indoor studio spaces was not possible, but nothing has stopped the music. Digital interactions, digital rehearsals, as well as a final digital compilation as well. This is from the Nunatak Band, which is in Paris, to percussionist B.C. Manjunath in Bengaluru.
On l'a fait une première fois, donc c'est ça qu'il a fait.
Il a
l'air trop bien à analyser celui-là aussi.
There are many fingering techniques for one phrase. Sometimes it is possible that I am not playing exactly what I've explained here because for the flow of the music.
That's a good news that it's not so mathematic.
Well, at this moment, I'm not really concentrating on the mathematics. Mathematics is only to begin with, and then everything is about logic to me, mm-hmm. Like it's a logical connection, and then everything is about the dynamics and the emotions in what I do. So mathematics is only to start.
J'avais envie de retourner en Inde et de collaborer avec Manjunath, sans trop savoir comment. Finalement, la contrainte de la distance a répondu à la question.
Tadigin na to